the Flat Earth Society if they would look into the question of the curvature of the Earth. It was just absurd. But they took sticky tape samples, putting the tape down and peeling it off, and the priests who were standing nearby would cringe when they'd hear this sort of ripping sound, but it didn't do anything very harmful. It just lifting off microfibrils off the shroud cloth, but with it any debris. It could have been any number of things. I put him on microscope slides, and Walter got these. And he began to identify what was on the shroud. And he did this double blind so that he knew he could look at those slides, and he could say, this slide has no appreciable anything on it, just some debris or bits of this and that. This one, however, has a red iron oxide, that is a pigment known as red ochre. And he could sort these out just by looking at them with his expert eye, simple matter. And guess what? The samples from the figure, not the background, had all the pigment. So this was not some kind of contaminant, couldn't be dismissed as just some mistake. And furthermore, this particular picture is a picture showing what he called pigment medium agglomerates from a blood area. That is, the blood was not blood, it was tempera paint, made of red ochre and vermilion pigments with maybe a little bit of another red colorant, rose madder. All particular pigments that were used by artists in the middle of the 14th century to paint blood. And if you're thinking to yourself, but why didn't the artist use some burial spices and get some real blood and so forth? Because, boys and girls, the concept that things could be tested or anything like that was far, far into the future. It was just how it looked. It had to look okay. And the artist wanted his image to really look good. For example, when you look at this image, and then you consider what it would really look like if you did an imprint of a real face, and so I'll use my own face here. That's an imprint of my face. And although you see the stipple pattern of my actual mustache, notice how elongated these eye sockets are, and how broken the nose is, and the distortions and asymmetry. And this is, I used heroic means I won't bother you with to make this as good an image as been said to be one of the best ever. It's a miserable failure. Now let me show you the reversal. Pretty realistic and gruesome looking. I know you're saying, someone right back over there saying he's better looking. Getting also something from your grandfather. No, I forgot where I was from. And this is not the shroud face, because the artist couldn't have something that looked that real. It had to look nice because it's holy, it's Jesus. Well, to make a long story short, I figured out how to make a shroud-like image, and what I did was to use a bas-relief, which reduces the amount of depth. And I used a technique similar to gravestone rubbing, and I produced an image, which you see. And then the reversal of it, does that not look pretty photographic?
Mm-hmm.
Pretty good, isn't it? And it has many of the features of the shroud. Let me just show you one of my, there's a close-up of that. I think it looks very photographic. And this is one of my shroud images. One of my images was mistaken for the shroud by the Associated Press one Easter and was sent out. And we had a lot of fun giggling amongst ourselves over it. People wanted me to come forward and I said, no, don't kick off the Associated Press. Just let it go and just be our little, some people knew about it. Not the Shroud of Turin. Well, and then, of course, the shroud was radiocarbon dated. Do you imagine that the shroud dated to A, the time of the time of Christ, B, the time of the Fortress Confession, Or C, the birthday of George Washington. Which one? Yes, that's right, the time of the forger's confession, practically to the month, and Walter had predicted that. Three different laboratories confirmed it. Well, you saw my book on the Shroud of Turin. I also did this book, Looking for a Miracle. And I have a newer one called The Science of Miracles. Not too many years ago, I got calls from a Hollywood scriptwriter, and eventually it turned out that Hilary Swank was making a movie based on moi. We found it out. Barry Carr had talked to the people at the movie, and he said, well, you need to look at Joe's book, Looking for a Miracle. And they said, oh, we have several copies, and Hilary's reading one now. And Warner Pictures then invited me to St. Francisville, Louisiana, to meet Hilary and be on the set for some of the filming. It was a great honor until I found what a just awful, terrible, embarrassingly bad movie it was. I felt sorry for Hilary Swank, who, let me tell you, is a very bright and very engaging actress or actor, and I really valued meeting her. I think you can just look this way and see why she would be chosen to play. It seems to me it's pretty obvious. Well, let's move on, because they're going to come out with that hook if I don't move on. Another big case of mine was at Camp Chesterfield, Indiana. This was where there were a number of exposés in the nature of spiritualism. You know, perhaps this figure. If you read his book, Crossing Over, near the back, you will see my name, the name of Psychop, our original name, the name of John Hockenberry, and Dateline NBC, for what he calls our gotcha moment. Well, let me just say a word about that. The Dateline asked if I would consult with them. They were going to plan to have John Edward read some people, and would I kind of be an advisor and so forth. So I was happy to do that. I told him to be careful and not to, you know, tell him, let him mill about with the people to be read, because he could pick up information. What's called hot reading. And they did. But during the reading, he begins to say, I'm getting an Anthony, and nobody's saying anything. I'm something about a coffin. Anthony has a ring. It's sounding fairly specific. It turns out that all of a sudden, one of the two Dateline cameramen is overcome with emotion. And the other cameraman sort of takes over and photographs him, and he's really caught up in emotion. He had a father named Anthony, and there was indeed a ring and all this. Well, when he kind of came to his senses, the cameraman remembered that he had told John Edward about this earlier in the day. So they had kept him from the audience, but they hadn't kept him from the cameraman doing B-roll shots all afternoon. And so John Hockenberry zeroed in and said, isn't it true that you knew this information? And you watched John Edward squirm on Dateline. He said, but you knew this going into it, but you pretended, or you let people think that you just got this from the spirit realm. And John Edward kept trying to joke out of it, get his way out of it, and Hockenberry didn't let him. So I like to say, once again, hey, John, we caught you cheating. So I went to Camp Chesterfield, which is one of the big notorious spiritualist camps, maybe the notorious one in America, where there have been many exposés, and I went undercover and in disguise. I shaved off my mustache, did a makeover, and limped painfully into Camp Chesterfield under the name Jim Collins. That's a little in joke. That was the name of Houdini's assistant. And Jim told everybody who would listen the sad, sad story of the death of his mother, and he went on and on about it, and how guilt-ridden he was, and so forth. They had readings on the grounds, and so forth. Well, one day, Jim, slipped into a church where they're having a service, and they were doing what's called billet reading. Now, a billet is a little slip of paper, and you fold it up, and they collect it into a basket, and then the medium holds one of the slips, the folded slips up. Can't see in it, you see. And he answers the questions. You were to write the names of people who'd passed over, and then a question. So, of course, I wrote the names of Collins people, and then the question, Mother, will you be with me always? Mm-hmm. Now, the lady at the door, I went back and asked her, I said, now, how was I to fold this, pretending not to be very bright? And she said, well, you must fold it just in half. If you fold it any other way, they won't read it. So, being a magician and occasional mentalist, I know many ways to do billet reading, and I was on to this particular version right away. So think about it. I'm going to let you in on a magic trick, and of course you'll all have to be exterminated, but but I'll let you in on it for the moment. Think about it this way. If you fold yours in half, you fold yours in half and half again, you fold yours into a triangle, you fold yours by pleating it, you would have some idea when it's held up here, that's not mine, wouldn't you?
Mm-hmm.
If you were paying attention. So why does he want them all to look exactly alike? Because you'll see in a minute. And why does he want them only folded once? You'll see. Because what can happen is we draw out one and it's held up here, but under cover of the podium, I can just use my thumb to flip open one and read it right down here. Everybody get that?
Mm-hmm.
So he's doing this billet reading, and I'm on to him, and people are crying because he's giving them messages from their dead loved ones and so forth. And I'm sitting in the back, stewing, angry. And finally he said, I have a message for the Collins family. Back here, I say, here, me. And he begins to read off the names of the Collins family, people who had passed over. And finally, he said, your mother wants you to know she'll always be there for you. I was very moving. I was near tears. And then I remembered that my mother was still alive and wasn't named Mrs. Collins. And I felt so much better. Because I had caught another one of these charlatans, and as a result, I published this and several other exposés from Camp Chesterfield in a big article in Skeptical Inquirer. And I understood, it was put out, that they had fired two or three people. Sent them off the grounds. I imagine that lasted a week or two. Or something. But anyway, you do the best you can. And then the final case I want to share with you, and I think I still have some time. Across 30 miles of desert pampas in Peru are the Nazca. These are great swaths, straight lines that run ruler straight for miles. And giant, they're called geoglyphs, giant pictorials of birds and other animals. So large that they can't really be seen or appreciated on the ground. This one, for example, that you're looking at is the giant condor. You will see it another time or two, so. Take a look at that giant bird. This is the condor in the center. This is more of a survey type drawing of it, an accurate drawing. And some of the other figures for scale in the lower corner, but just to give you an idea, the condor is 440 feet long. From tip of beak to tip of tail feathers, a football field and a half. And even I, who thought I could make one, I was going to roll up my shirt sleeves and go out and make it masculine, because Eric Von Däniken and his Chariots of the Gods and other pseudo-historical and pseudo-scientific works were claiming that the Nazcas couldn't have made these mere non-white savages. Just racist talk throughout Von Däniken's book, in my opinion, premised on just racism. But he was trying to convince us that the Nazcas couldn't have made these drawings, because how could they? And I thought that, in fact, that they could indeed do it. And there was all kinds of evidence that dated these to the Nazca culture. I mean, these figures are very similar to these kinds of... Notice how sort of stylistic these drawings are. They're not just, you know, simple-minded copied pictures, but sort of artistically stylistic. Very sophisticated, I think, in many ways. These are similar to the figures on the Nazca pottery, which is just beautiful stuff. If you ever have a chance to look at Nazca pottery, it's wonderful, it's breathtaking. And I've seen a lot of them. So here is this giant drawing, and I'm going to make a recreation of it, I think, and I get a Kentucky landfill and a little crew of, you know, cousins and nephews and so forth, and we go out, about six of us, and we lay out a center line. So we drive a post, and then we measure 440 feet long, and we put another post up, and between that, I'm going to make a giant drawing. I can tell you, even as confident as I was, that when I saw how just far away those posts were, that I gulped, and it got really serious then. But I believe that I can make one of almost any size. You have to sort of think. Walter will forgive me, I hope, and not think small this time. You have to think big. Think big, Walter, sometimes. So I won't give you all the details of how we did it, but just very basically, on the ground. And let me point out, so when I show you a picture, I want you to see here. See how black the earth is back there in the background? Okay, this earth is a landfill area, so parts of it are whitish clay. Parts are yellow dirt. Parts are black shale, just brought in the dump trucks and dumped willy-nilly. So when you see the aerial photo, it looks very patchwork. But just trust me, it's flat as a pancake. It's not rugged or anything like that, just flat and splotchy in color. But we drew a center line, and then we had a small 6-foot drawing. Now, Maria Reich, the German mathematician who spent her life at Nazca to save the Nazca lines, that became a hero to the people of Peru, and when she died, they lowered the flag to half staff. Maria, I've been to her former home and paid my respects at her grave. And much of what I did, I relied on her data, part of which was the creation of a unit she called the Nazca foot. It's kind of arbitrary. She came up with something. Doesn't matter. I just needed some unit. Didn't matter. And what I'm going to do is for any feature like the shoulder point, I'm going to come down the center line on the small drawing and at right angles. So many units down, and so many units across to that point, okay? And then on the ground, I'm going to come down so many larger units and over so many larger units and drive a stake. And then we're going to connect those dots. And then where the Nazcas picked up rock, there's the ground littered with stone. I couldn't find a place like that, so I just used a football field marker to mark the lines. Not really cheating, because you'll grasp that the essence of this is how to make the drawing, not the busy work of picking the stones, right? So we connected them with string. I doubt that the Nazcas did that. I used a lot of overkill. I used a lot of points. The result, when we flew over it, and my cousin John May was in the plane with me. He was a photographer. I was sitting in the back seat. John was in the passenger side. The pilot was flying the plane about 1,000 feet. And the pilot would go over this figure we'd recreated and bank the plane. And John is leaning out the open window. And I know this sounds very dangerous, and I appreciate your thought and your empathy there, but I was holding on to his belt. and in fact, I was very safe. So we didn't lose John. He was getting these direct photos straight down, and I'll show you then one of these.
Wow.
Scientific American said my recreation was remarkable in its exactness to the original. In fact, it was so good that this line is a mistake. It should be papered the other way. And we didn't notice it, but we copied it faithfully. So whatever's on this small drawing, I'm kind of glad we made the mistake because it gave us a measure of how good we were. But again, I think we used overkill. And people had said to me, maybe the Nazcas had surveying equipment since lost. But I, as a boy, I was a surveyor's chainman. My neighbor was a surveyor. I know a lot about surveying. And I can assure you that no surveying equipment was used because you have to run a continuous line and all your errors are adding up at the end. And you have this, what's called error of closure, which in a real survey would be minimal and negligible. Here would have been huge. Another theory was that it was done by a grid system, but think how much trouble it would be to lay out a grid of squares. And then even so, notice the asymmetry of this figure. The wings are askew, look at the claws, they're mismatched. There's a lot of error in there if this was done with the grid system, because the grid system will not allow you to get things out of kilter like that. All your errors are within a given square and therefore minimal. So I came up with this method. People said when I published this that I had shown how the Nazcas made their drawings. And I said, well, I did no such thing. All I did was show that with simple, I used one pair of cross sticks for sighting, and I used two sets of knotted cord to measure. That was it. So I think they could have done something like this. Anyway, this is one of my proudest cases. I, for a long time, maybe still, I'm the only one I knew that made a giant geoglyph, and the time went on. And then one day, oh, and this is a picture of me. I wish I still looked like.
Wow.
My goodness. Oh well. This is me standing in one of the giant claws. This is a photo made by stepladder. So again, it gives you some scale. And again, you see the black streak through the claw there, and so forth. But you really need to be way up in the air to see it. But we found that if we brought unsuspecting people to the area and allowed them to walk around, you can see, can't you? You can see a claw. You can see that pretty well. Just walking on the ground. And you can see a beak and a head. And you can add it up in your mind. And we tried this on people, and they could figure out what we were doing on the ground. They didn't have to be up in the air. And they didn't need a flying saucer. Maria had said that if the spacemen came in, the ground was pretty soft there. She said, I'm afraid they would have gotten stuck. Well, so time went on, and this is the Nazca spider, which I'm going to get to now. National Geographic called. When they do, I always take their calls. And I did maybe, I'd say 12 or 13 shows for one series alone. It was called Is It Real? Do you remember that?
Mm-hmm.
And I was the guy that would come on and say, no, it isn't. Remember that? I would come on occasionally. Not every show. Anyway, they called and they wanted me to make them a giant Nazca geoglyph. Well, I said, please don't make me do that. I'm an old guy. This is hard work. I did this when I was young and foolish and blah, blah, blah. And I said, I've shown that it can be done. I've proven my point to pictures and so forth. And she, the producer, said lightheartedly, yes, but you didn't film it. Mm-hmm. You got me there, I said. You got me there. She said, well, what we would really like is for you to make the giant spider. And I thought quickly, oh, that's not as big as the giant condor. And my mind was running, and of course I didn't say to her anything like that. Oh, it'd be very difficult, I said, great hardship, and blah, blah, blah. But anyway, so finally I agreed. They'll have helpers for me and so forth. And finally, on a ranch in California, and I was able to kill two birds with one stone. I got to stay in the haunted Hollywood Roosevelt Hotel where Marilyn Monroe's ghost is. And I can't say more about that. But here is my result. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Spider-Man. Back to the original picture that I showed you, and there's a mystery that remains. I didn't solve it, but I think I did as much as anyone to kind of put it together and so forth. But notice these drawings, and notice that each drawing is drawn with a continuous line. The giant pencil does not lift until the pencil gets back to the starting point. That's one feature. And notice that each of these figures has a pair of extraneous lines, like the spider has a pair going on the leg, the monkey has a pair going up to the base of the tail. This one gave me pause for a long time, but it is disguised as the beak. But they all have. And here's the thing, if you walk in one of those lines, which has no purpose for layout or drawing or any purpose that anyone has ever imagined really, walk one of those lines, you will traverse the entire figure and come out the other one. These, ladies and gentlemen, these drawings are giant labyrinths. A friend of mine, Tony Avini, an astronomer and archaeologist, calls labyrinths in the desert. And we believe these were ritual walking paths. Yeah. I'm confident that that's the true purpose of the Nazca lines. They had nothing to do with flying saucers. Thank you again.